למשה רבנו לקחו 40 שנה
Moses
it took 40
years to take our forefathers into freedom. Where were we 40 years ago? Without a home computer, no internet, no mobile phones, no databases, with a healthy democracy that just now changed the leading party after many years because of corruption, and with the peace accords with Egypt in 2 months, we will be celebrating 40 years, that was done by the Israeli political leader who people did not expect him to do it. Did someone believe 40 years ago that an officer, a minor officer, going to fight with terrorists is dependent upon the Attorney General's decision more than his commander-in-chief? Did people think that the results of a physics research will shut down shopping malls and newspapers? Did anybody think and believe that GDP in Israel will be double that of Saudi Arabia? Did someone believe that we're going to have people who will define that person, on the one hand, as a delirious left-winged person, and on the other hand, a right fascist, and that person who will hear these words will be proud of both definitions because of the ones who said them? Did anybody dream that a physics professor will stand here talking about danger to democracy? The fact is, that all of these happened and we couldn't believe it. They're all out of reach of anybody's imagination, and at a certain place we all know that there is a very close link between all of these factors who seem to be completely unrelated. And this is going to be the topic that I'm dealing with, and its connection to democracy in the world and particularly in Israel. And before we go and speak about democracy, several words, several understandings about science and technology that I must reinforce here, because they're penetrating each and every corner of our lives. So first and foremost, I'm going to omit in a very wild way all sorts of developments that stem out of modern technologies. And still, after I have devoted my entire life to science, I continue to believe that science is one of the humane, most fascinating, most exciting activities. They're aesthetic no less than art, they're challenging, and they have brought great benefit to humanity, whether it is medicine, nutrition, and any other area. So have no misunderstanding. This is not an indictment against science. These are tears for terrible times that come to us because of technological developments, and maybe here and there are some ideas of how to tackle this. However, everything I have said in these 30 seconds was true 50 years ago, 20 years ago, and today, and will be true always. The pure science was always wonderful and challenging in everything that I have said, but something happened in the past 40 years. Science and technology and their fruit, which is intellectual property, patents, inventions, became the most important financial asset worldwide. The four largest societies in the world, as far as the value of society nowadays, are Amazon, not in this particular order, the order could change from day to day, Amazon, Apple, Microsoft, and Alphabet, which is a subsidiary of Google, or the holding company of Google. This is 100% a result of technology, which is 100% a result of science. Neither one of the classic companies, whether it is financial or petrol companies or anyone else. The fact that Israel now has a GDP which is over $40,000 annually.
And
Saudi Arabia has hardly 20,000. It stems exactly from this. We could say that 1 gram of knowledge equals more than 1 barrel of oil. And this goes everywhere. It goes into the economy and policy and war and everywhere. There's nowhere where science and technology is not present. And this is why they're also within politics. If we look at environmental issues, communication, agriculture, industry, water, security, and even archaeology, everywhere you find science. They say that Italian archaeologists in Rome found in the excavations a very thin and long wire, and they immediately wrote in their journal that the ancient Romans used telephones. And then Israeli archaeologists came to Jerusalem and they searched the old city, such a cable, and they couldn't find such a wire, and they said that the ancient Israelis used cell phones. So archaeology also has these kind of things. There's also an amazing penetration of quantitative thought to a thousand of places, to all sorts of investments, insurance, medical probabilities, the issue of big data, some demagogic articles that use with mathematical equations. Some are worthy and some are worth nothing, and more and more. And there are workplaces that vanish, ones that are based on working hands, and workplaces that are based on knowledge, thinking, and particularly scientific knowledge are created. So it's not right to say that the number of workplaces decreases, but their character changes. And here we have a social danger more than political, because the distribution of knowledge and talent is more different, is more extreme than the distribution of manual work. There is a very bad opportunity to increase social gaps. And we can deal with this in only one way: education, 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 education at large, education towards knowledge and scientific knowledge, but not only. All of these together create a picture which is so different than what we saw 40 and even 20 years ago. And there isn't a single profession that you learn today that doesn't have science. In the law, internet, patents, intellectual property, taxation of intellectual property in a geographical context, etc., etc. Ministers, managers, generals cannot pass a day without a minimum technological scientific knowledge. This is a fascinating topic unto itself. We don't have time to deal with it right now. But it would take us to this wondrous connection of science and technology with politics. And now, first lesson in extremism. Is science good or bad? We all know that science does wonderful things like inventing life-saving medicines and all sorts of diagnostic processes. And science does bad things like developing a mass destruction weapon and all sorts of other things. Someone said at the time a very nice statement, are our hands good or bad? We can caress with hands, we can suffocate somebody, we can struggle somebody. Well, it's not good or bad, it depends on what we do with it, and this is also true for science. But think about it, it's not so simple, because when your hands caress, maybe you're sexually harassing someone. And when you're trying to struggle somebody, maybe it's that terrorist who already murdered 3 people and that's the only way to prevent him from going to the fourth person. So in all of these extreme things, there is logic, which is both right and wrong. There is logic that needs measurability, everything to the extreme. But in politics, it entails deep thinking, fundamental thinking.
המדע בין השאר הוליד את כל מה שאנחנו חיים היום באינטרנט וברשתות חברתיות, והגענו כבר למצב שלא רק שחנויות וקניינים נסגרים מפני שאתם קונים אונליין, ולא רק עיתונים נסגרים מפני שאתם כל הזמן קוראים את אתרי החדשות ולא
your news online,
but you're exposed
only to what your bubble relates to you, because if you have read three articles in a certain political direction, the network puts into your head only articles from this direction and not from the other direction. Try it for yourself. Search, for example, a hotel in Barcelona for several minutes on your computer, and then try to see who received a Nobel Prize of Medicine. And you will see that when you get the laureates on the side, you immediately have pop-ups of advertisements for a Barcelona hotel. So the system knows exactly what you do, and this goes into politics, and actually Obama's election, this was the first world election campaign where this was playing, and now we have it everywhere. And this ultimately gets us to this issue of danger to democracy. We have a crazy flood of information which is attacking us from all sides, in all means, phones, computers, WhatsApp, SMS, YouTube, Facebook, everything that you can think about. The younger you are, the more you are underwater, so to speak, in this flood. The messages are very short for two reasons. First of all, this is how technology is constructed. Tweets or Twitter is limited to 140 digits, including everything. And in a very short message, you can only say something extreme. You can say everyone's good, everyone's bad, everyone's evil, everyone's murderers. You cannot say this, but there are some others who will do it differently, and this is justified, and this entails your discretion, and this entails your thinking, and maybe, and maybe, and maybe. And so, this takes us to a politics of extremes everywhere in the world, a right extreme, a left extreme, and we'll talk about the connection of the two in a minute. The problems are longer nowadays due to those scientific technological developments. Lifespan, life expectancy is longer due to the novelties of medicine, the issues of pension, retirement, dealing with the elderly are more severe due to technological successes. Climate change is a problem of a generation span. Dealing with it needs scientific know-how. The entire issue of development of education and science, making them accessible as a means to prevent enlarging of gaps. This is something we cannot resolve overnight. No quickies in education, no quickies in science. There are only ministers of education that make sure to have a reform every 3 months, and they always go against the previous reform. But we don't see anything like that anymore. We have people elect who are not even planning for the four traditional years until next elections, because they're only planning it until they're going to leave their party or go to a new party. On the other hand, the problems are problems for generations, and there's no motivation for the public officials to resolve such problems, because if they do it, no one is going to give them credit, and no one is going to blame them if they fail, because no one is going to recall who tackled it. And this issue that we are exposed to our bubble of support is also a danger to democracy, because the entire wisdom in democracy is that I can change my mind. How can I change my mind if I have an overgoing flood of reinforcing my previous opinion? And maybe what is bothering me most of all as a scientist is that there is an algorithm kind of a process, very logical. Even in science, we need breakthroughs in logic. But in normative life, This is a certain. You don't find, for example, you don't want any public official to look for a parking spot in one small street. He'll find this parking spot, he'll go into it in a regular way, he'll need to go reverse 3 meters, and the security camera of a grocery shop on the side will shoot a video of those 10 seconds when he goes against direction on a One Direction Street. This is going to be a headline the following day. Did he do a moral felony? Someone is going to file a complaint. Someone can use this. I'm choosing a completely idiotic example in order to exemplify where this logic can take us. And the moment there is an autonomous car, it will prevent him from doing this. And further and further. And if we're talking about parking in a one-direction street, that's okay. But if we talk about developing the Negev, the southern area, if the government decides to put millions of shekels, and this will be stopped because of these stupid occurrences, and they will, we are in a political distress, in a democratic distress. So we have some sort of a syndrome that I call the binary syndrome. It's all an extreme, yes or no, left or right. We don't have anything in the middle. And this brings about two things. First of all, extremism and populism. And secondly, we have this no man's land in the middle, where life takes you. And then somebody has to decide about this issue that's called measurability, proportionality, and the fact that the courts of law took this under their wings. It's okay. But the fact that we have these consultants, a legal consultant also taking over this issue, that's not okay, because this issue is not a legal thing. It is rather an issue of common sense. And I don't see any advantage of one profession over another in measuring this common sense between the two extremes. If you walk a straight line to the end and you get to the further end, and if you go to the other side, you get to the other far end, and the two ends are different than one another. This was the classical way, right or left, fascism, wild fascism, or left, wild communism. Both are murderers, and ultimately this is what history showed. However, let's have a lesson in geometry. If you have a circle and you follow it all the way through from this way or the other way, you would reach the exact same point. And all of a sudden you see that the left wings are supporting Muslim Brothers, which is the worst, as worst as it gets. And then it turned out that in Italy there is a party which is ruling, which is certainly populist, but we don't know if it's right, left, or right wing or left wing. It's all sorts of such phenomenon. You see the Islamic movement and Hadash going to the Knesset election under the same list. And where do they all converge? I have a suggestion for this point. They're meeting at a sort of a plaza, and I call it the Molotov-Ribbentrop Plaza. We have a terminology nowadays. The Party of Freedom is the opposite of freedom. It's the fascists in Europe. Peace activists, it's the opposite of peace in most cases. Human rights have become only human rights for terrorists, for criminals, and for certain types of people, not for the normal people who also have rights. And now, in Israel, they introduced something that I suggest all of these professionals prevent. This is the threshold guardians. In the Bible, this is Biktan and Teresh who tried to kill King Ahasuerus. And in the nightclub, these are bouncers who will decide who's coming in and who's not. This is a very bad world. Don't call them gatekeepers, because they're not. And all of these terminologies, it's as if I'm only dealing with the criminology, but that's not the story.
יש לנו מושג שנקרא חופש.
We have this term called freedom. We all for freedom of speech, freedom of the academy, freedom of the media and journalism, but none of these freedoms is absolute. An academic freedom does not allow a physics professor to say that the world was created 5,000 years ago, and doesn't allow a history professor to say that the Holocaust never occurred. And freedom of creation does not allow someone to introduce into the museum work about pedophilia, and freedom of speech does not include freedom of incitement and transparency. This is a very vague term. It now prevents a time of video and recording. It prevents an open discussion and a real brainstorming without which we cannot reach intelligent decisions anywhere, because everyone is afraid to say something stupid that might reach newspapers the next day. And without stupid ideas, you cannot reach good ideas. Everybody who sat in such discussions knows very well, knows it very well. So we are in a bind there. And the freedom of journalism, protecting your sources, it encourages the ones who want it, not generally, fake news and distorting the news. And we started with Moses, so we're going to say another word about Moses. When he and the people of Israel came to the place where the Egyptians were chasing them, and there was a problem with the water that are going to be a barrier between the Egyptians and Israelites, he asked his scientific consultant, he said, bring in a bulldozer and try to dig a tunnel. And Moses asked, how long is this going to take? It's going to take 2 months. Moses said, I have no time for that. They're coming tomorrow, these Egyptians. And then he went to his media consultant and he said, stand like this, the day is going to split, we are going to move in the middle, they will drown in the water. And then Moses said, you think it's going to succeed? The consultant said, I don't know, but if it will, I'll make sure that you get a full page on the in the Bible. And that's the way we lead our lives. And so we're going to conclude this point in a very simple manner, but a sad one. Our lives are longer, but the range of our thought is shorter. And when I say us or we, this is leadership, management, and the way things are being done. We live in a global world, and in most cases we think on a global level. I'm not blaming technology directly, this was always true, but technology amplified all of this in a very wild manner in the past 20 years. So all of this was always here, but it's amplified. So in order not to finish on a pessimistic note, are we going to let go of democracy as a result of all of that? No, no way. But liberal democracy is not something that we can sum up in one tweet, in one line, in one saying. Montesquieu, who talked about separating the authorities, lived 300 years ago, and most people around him didn't know how to read or write. Things can be altered a little bit. We need privatization, but it doesn't have to be the historical manner that the British mandate talked about. And if we need someone to set up proportionality, it doesn't have to be the legal advisor. Judges, yes, but not those legal consultants in the government office. Too many times I was sitting opposite a minister regarding a project, and he was looking at his legal advisor, and he the one nodded his head, because you need to issue that tender or the other and go to the lowest bid that is going to be given to you by someone who is completely incompetent. And this is how things are being done on a daily basis in our systems. And if we can limit the age of voters who will be from 18 or from 16 onwards, maybe we can have other limitations. Maybe people in my age will not be able to vote, particularly if they're senile, maybe some other things. I don't have any propositions, concrete one, but the crisis in world democracy and also here is leading us for a need for changes, for rethinking, and not only changing the methodology of elections.
העובדה שאנחנו בוחרים 100 איש או
120
בארץ או 600
בבריטניה, elect one or 120 people here and allow them to decide everything in 4 years time, is this really the right way to go about it? I don't have answers. However,
אז כדי לסיים ברוח הימים האלה,
in order to finish with these days' spirit, I need to declare that we need a new political party, that of common sense. It's going to be called Meshi. It will not run for elections. It will not go into the Israeli parliament. It will simply sneak its people into all other parties until they take over. And then maybe we could salvage democracy. And if we don't do it ourselves, what happened in Hungary and Venezuela, what happened in the Arab Spring, Trump's tweets and Jeremy Corbyn, it's only the promo for the bad news we will hear about in the world. But I'm optimistic. I believe the democracy will be triumphant. But if it's going to be done in a bloody revolution, or is it going to be done because we are wise, that's the question. And I'm optimistic regarding the last opportunity. Thank you very much.